Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Spinnaker Lounge for the Liars Club, the game show where you, the audience, has to decide who is telling the truth and who is lying. Videotaping and flash photography is highly recommended, but why anyone would want a picture of these losers is beyond me. At this time, we present to you our star-studded panel of liars. Our first panelist just returned from a schizophrenia convention where he was promoting his new book, Life is Good for the Both of Us. Tonight, sponsored by petroleum jelly to ensure that his balls keep moving freely, please welcome your comedy juggler, Romano Frediani. Our second panelist likes to eat, drink, and be merry. He's been on in the wagon for the last year, and although he's on a diet, he most often still likes to be called Mary. Tonight, sponsored by Johnson's Baby Powder, as he says, it makes those hard-to-dry areas feel just magical. Please welcome your comedy entertainer, Jeff Harms. Our third panelist was voted one of the top 10 sexiest men alive. Well, let's face it, he does have the perfect face for radio. Tonight, sponsored by Viagra to ensure he gets up in the morning, please welcome to the stage your cruise director, Jimmy Kovel. Our final panelist's hobbies include shopping, men, and shopping for men. Tonight, sponsored by Hooters. She wishes. Please welcome to the stage your assistant cruise director, Ingrid Thomas. Every game show is not complete without a Vanna, and we could not get the real one, or frankly, anything close to a Vanna. So we got the next best thing the best Canadian currency can buy. Please welcome to the stage for the final time from your cruise director staff, Megan Bruneau. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands down and your drinks together for your host this evening, me. First time I've had to use that. All right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Liars Club. This is your opportunity to participate in a live game show, and this, in fact, is going to be a panel of liars all evening. This is your opportunity to decide who's telling the truth and who is lying. Now, before we started the game show here tonight, Megan went around and gave you each numbers for your team, H. So let's find out where you are. Just by a round of applause, where is team number one? Wow.
That sucked.
Let's have a little more out of team number two. Where's team number three? Team number four. Team five. Team six.
Alcoholics.
Team seven. Team number eight. Team 9. And finally, Team 10. Very good. So as we said earlier on today, if you were at Bingo, we mentioned that this game show involves giving specific words with specific explanations. Each one of our panelists will be giving their own version of what they think that word means. These words are unusual, and it's up to you to decide who is telling the truth and who is lying. After each panelist gives their explanation, we'll go through a quick recap of that word and explanation, and then we'll turn it over to you very quickly to decide who you think is telling the truth and who is lying. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and start with our first word, Vanna, if you please. The word is Flitterbic. Flitterbic.
and a hush comes over the room.
Flitterbeck. All right, the word is flitterbeck, and let's start all the way at the end of the table with Romano.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How's everybody doing tonight? Good? That's what we like to hear. Now, the word is flitterbeck. Flitterbeck is what you get when you ask somebody with ADD to light your cigarette. Actually, I know this because I happen to speak a couple of languages. If you were at the second show last night, you may have heard me speak some German, and this is actually a German word. I'll give you a few examples. Like, the German word for bra is the Stoppen für Floppen. The German word for virgin is Guten Tag, Guten Tag. And the German word for a litter bug is Flitterbeck. Flitterbeck, and that's what this word is, Flitterbeck, the German word for litter bug.
German word for litter bug. Now, folks, I did forget to mention that if at any time that you get the sense or the feeling that any one of our panelists are lying, feel free to shout out liar at your own convenience. It will happen.
You look great tonight.
Flitterbeck. Ingrid.
Good evening, folks. How are we doing? I would first like to say it's such an honor and a pleasure to be sitting up here with such handsome gentlemen.
You're catching on.
Flitterbeck is actually one of the unknown mythical creatures. There's a lot of mythical creatures that we do know of, like the unicorn.
Goes along with the H, yeah.
Yeah. And the unicorn are like the little gnomes. These are the unknown mythical creatures, and flitterbeck is one of them. You may have heard of a certain mythical creature. It has the body of a pig, but the head of a donkey. It's called the Donaldus trumpetus. Two floppy ears. One ear is always flopped over to the other side, and puckers its lips when it speaks. And yeah, that's one of the.
You're fired.
Thank you. Freedom. Alright. There's another mythical creature you may have seen on board, actually. It has the body of a horse and the head of a giraffe. It's called the Crusius Directus. It's often found yakking and yak, 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 just all.
Now you're fired.
Bring it on, lady, bring it on.
This mythical creature is often found wandering the forests alone. And it's a very rare mythical creature. And the flitterbeck is one of them. The flitterbeck is actually a mythical flying squirrel that flies so fast that no one has ever seen it. Thank you.
Mythical flying squirrel.
That flies so fast no one has ever seen it.
All right, very good. Jeff.
I think the Crusius Directus, isn't that? That's like they're vanishing because they're impotent.
That's right.
That species.
Last of their kind.
Yeah, they can't reproduce. How you doing, folks? Good. Is anyone here from Ohio or Pennsylvania?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Wow, fantastic. Then you know that there's a group of people in those two states, predominantly in the U.S., who tend to keep away from mainstream society and live a much simpler life. Anyone know what I'm referring to, or who I'm referring to? The Amish. And for many years, I was an Amishman. It's true. I was known as Caleb the Indecisive. My job as an Amishman was to work the fields with a hoe. I was a hoer. I was an Amish hoer. I was a male hoer. And I was known for not charging a lot. I was a cheap male Amish hoer. My whole family were hoers. In my spare time, I helped the fishermen with their bait. I was a hooker. So I was a hoer and a hooker. And I would take the paint off the old barn, so I was a stripper. I was a hoer, hooker, and stripper. You know what I did in my spare time? I tried to do magic. I was turning tricks. So I was a hoer, hooker, stripper, and turning tricks. One day, my father, I had an Amish girlfriend. You know how I broke up with her? Told her I'd call her. You see me? Also, I went to Quaker State, which is in one day, my father, Lars, the testy, he came to me. He said, son, thine hoeing, hooking, stripping and tricks doth vex myself, and your mother Doris. My mother wasn't a native Amish woman. She had the beard, but, you know, she joined. And so what I became was a loomer. If anyone's ever made blankets and quilts, that's, you do it on a loom. You pedal and the wheel of the loom revolves, and that's what I did. I used the natural fibers from the earth, like nylon, dacre. And but it was an old-fashioned loom. I pedaled it, and the flitterbick is a wedged piece of triangular wood with a spring in it. It's a support piece at the base of a loom, and what it does is two things. The spring helps, enables you to move the wheel closer or further, depending on your comfort, and also the at the bottom, it keeps the wheel from the whole loom from moving away from you during the centrifugal force of the pedaling. It's a support piece at the base of a loom.
All right, very good. Support piece at the base of a loom. Let's go to your cruise director, Jimmy.
Hi, folks. How are you tonight? I actually know this word. Do we have anybody here from Angola? It's a word from Angola. No. I know this word because I used to date Ingrid a long time ago.
Someone yell out liar?
Nobody yelled out. Pay attention.
Thank you.
We broke up, though, a long time ago on the Norwegian Wind. I used to work with Jeff on the Norwegian Wind. And,
well, we'd broken up before that.
Yeah, we broke up before that. And we actually had a vacation planned, but of course we broke up. But we decided to go because we were still good friends. And we took a long trip. And even though we were kind of separated, we still decided to go. First stop was in Vegas. We went all the way to Vegas. And for the first couple nights, we went out gambling.
Poker, Jimmy?
No, we were just friends. But thanks, Romano. It was kind of a different type of trip. Ran out of money after a couple of days. We started, you know, going out and we had some drinks each and every night.
Liquor, Jimmy?
No, we were just friends, Romano, but thanks for asking. Did the whole Vegas thing, the gambling, drinking, and the shows. After a while, we had a nice trip planned up to New England. Went all the way up to the beautiful state of Maine.
Banger?
Yeah, Banger, Maine. Went up to Banger, Maine. With Ingrid. And, being from the Northeast, being from New England, I actually know what a flitterbick is. And I know that if people from the Northeast know, there's a lot of antique stores and things like that. And that's where you'll find a flitterbick. A flitterbick is an antique colonial lantern. That's what a flitterbick is called from the 17th to 18th centuries. It's a flitterbick, an antique colonial lantern.
Antique lantern. All right, let's go ahead and recap now. Let's go back to Romano for the recap of flitterbick.
A flitterbick is a gay midget who has just come out of the cupboard. Flitterbick is the German word for a litter bug.
Ingrid.
Flitterbick is a mythical flying squirrel that made off with Jimmy's nuts.
Jeff.
Was that before or after we dated?
It's a support piece at the base of a loom.
And Jimmy.
It's a term for an antique colonial lantern.
All right, folks, we turn it over to you now and your teams to briefly talk about it. Do that now. Teams, let's take a look now and see where we're at. Team number one, who do you think is telling the truth? Team number one? You're going with Jeff. Okay, you think it's Jeff telling the truth? That's number one. Number two? Two for Jeff. Three? Jeff. Team four? Team five?
What?
Team six? Team seven? Team 8.
We're playing two.
Teammate, your number's upside down.
Team number nine. And finally, team 10.
Landslide.
Landslide victory, absolutely. All right, would the panelist, who is telling the truth, please stand up now. Ingrid was telling the truth for that one. She got you. Mythical flying squirrel.
It's a mythical flying squirrel that flies so fast, no one has ever seen it. You can Google it. Go on, Google it.
Or go to the library for you guys.
She got you on that one. All right, ladies and gentlemen, now you know how the game works. Let's move on to our next word very rapidly. Here we go. Vanna, if you please.
Panel one, audience zero.
The next word is pisanya. Pisanya. Other side, Vanna. There you go. Pisanya. Pisanya. All right, the word is pisanya, and let's move one down the panel here and ask Ingrid pisanya.
Pisanya. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Pisanya is actually pronounced Fisanya with an F, and that's a proper way to say it because I'm a Filipino. We mix up our P's and our F's. Have you noticed that? We mix up our P's and our F's on board? No one's noticed. There's 700 of us on board. Sometimes I know I sound fairly American now because I actually grew up in Ohio with the Amish people.
Why is that funny?
It is. Yeah, so you know, Ingrid, a Filipina that grew up in Ohio. That's my life.
That's right next to Pennsylvania.
Yes, that's true. You know, Pittsburgh. Scooter. Pisanya is actually pronounced Pisanya. I sound American now, but sometimes when I get frustrated, I still mix up my P's and my F's. Like this one time, I farked my car by a power plug. And this policeman came by and said, "Hey, Filipina, you can't fart your car by the pyre plug." And I said, "No, it's okay. It's the pyreman that gives me the farking ticket, not the policeman." So I had to promise both the pyreman and the policeman that I would never fart my car by the pyre plug again. It was so frustrating. Aw, thank you.
I am dyslexic just listening to that.
Romano, you're part of my family. We'll miss you.
Do you ever eat Bill? You know, young cow? Like Bill Cutlet?
No, but this explains why we don't play hockey in the Philippines. Because we would have to...
That you hit with this stick, what do they call it, a hockey?
Yeah, it's a thing.
All right, Pisanya.
That's what it is. Pisanya, my definition actually is, I don't think I ever gave you my definition. what it is, folks, is back before the world looked like the way it did, it actually came from only two continents, two very large randomly shaped continents. It hadn't broken apart yet. One big part chunk of it was called the Pangaea continent. The other side was called the Pisanya, or the Pisanya continent. And that's the truth because Filipina girls never lie. Thank you.
Onboard comedian Jeff Arms.
I want to thank teams 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. You know, folks, I love words. I make my living with words, and I study words. As a matter of fact, in college, I majored in word study. And my mom said that I would go far if I learned how to talk good. And so when I first got out of college, I was a proofreader for M&M's. And I got fired. I threw out all the W's. But you have to think about words, you know? I mean, just like, for example, we're drinking Evian water, very expensive bottled water. You know, backwards, that's naive. You ever read in Mexico? Taco backwards. Oh, cat. Anybody from Oklahoma? Tulsa, a slut. Now let's move and get to this.
Oh, and Utah is hatu.
Which is Filipino for spinning, or spitting, because they can't spit, right? You spit,
which is Jewish for shower, right?
Yeah, you spit. What the hell are we talking about?
I know. The word is pisanya there, Jeff.
Anyway, is anyone here from Wales? Because I speak Walesish, and. Pisanya is a colloquialism in Welsh. It's a phrase. We all know colloquialisms, you know. Penny saved is a penny earned. I think Ben Franklin did that, you know. Stitch in time saves nine. Ace makes waste. Don't pee on my back and tell me it's raining. You know, things like that. Pisanya is a toast. It's actually a toast that they use in pubs in Wales. If you've ever been there, you won't hear it now. You'll hear it in the past, in Wells's past, when they were just two continents. So they'd go, "Hey, Angus, piss on ya." What's that, ma'am? Rubbish, that's another toast. That's a dirty place over there, if you've ever been.
All right, Jimmy.
What did you just say?
I got him with the Amish thing.
I know.
I thought I'd give him a break.
Pisanya is actually, anybody from Norway? It's a Norwegian word. And I actually learned this from talking to our captain. I don't know if you've ever heard our captain.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Bing Crosby on Quaaludes.
Yeah. No, he forgot the name of our executive chef, and he's been here over a year today. He forgot his name. Captain Andreas.
Okay.
Pisanya. I've talked to the captain, and he obviously lives in North Carolina now, but originally he was from Norway. And Pisanya is actually, we'll break the word down. No, we won't. But it is actually a term for a Norwegian word, a term to describe a river, kind of like a fjord that is formed by a glacier. A glacier that comes down off the mountain and forms a river is actually called a Pisanya.
River formed by a glacier. All right, let's go to, last but not least, Romano, your comedy juggler.
Pisanya is what you get when you are hit by a yellow snowball.
Watch out where the Huskies go.
Pisanya is also how you signal left while driving in New Jersey. No, I happen to know this because I used to run a halfway house for girls who went all the way. And at the time I was dating a homeless girl, which was great because I could drop her off anywhere. But we actually had an Australian nudist horticulturalist staying with us. She was from Australia, she was a nudist, and she was a horticulturalist. And every morning I would compliment her on her bush. And I would say, "Nice bush," and she would say, "Pisanya." And nicely, neatly trimmed bush. And apparently, it's only found down under. So that's what it is. It's a small, neatly trimmed bush that's only found down under. All right, let's go ahead and recap. Let's go to Ingrid.
It's the pre-tectonic shifted continent of Pisania next to the continent of Pangaea. Thank you.
Jeff Harms.
It's walking backwards naked into a doorknob. No, I'm sorry, I read that wrong. It's on my to-do list. It's,
Jingle the handle.
If you wait till we're pulling into port, you won't need to.
What did I say? It's a toast, yeah. It's a Welsh toast.
Sure it is.
Jimmy.
Pisania is a Norwegian term used to describe a fjord or river formed by a glacier.
And Romano.
A small, neatly trimmed bush that's only found down under.
All right, teams, we turn it over to you. Talk about it now. Teams, let's hear from you. Team number one, who is telling the truth? Who are you going with? You're going with Bush. That would be Romano.
Yes, thank you.
Team two, Jimmy. Team three, Ingrid. Mixed bag here.
Did you hear what I said? Just...
Team four, Romano. Team five, Team six, me. Team seven.
Yeah.
That was Jeff, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Team eight. Jimmy. Team nine. Jimmy. Team ten. Romano. All right, audience, it's time to decide who's telling the truth. And would the panelist who's telling the truth please stand up now? It was Romano. You got it.
Sorry, guys.
All right, moving right along to our third word of the... Hello, Vanna. Doing very good. How you doing? Doing great. You got the next word ready for us? Maybe. You guys want to see the next word? All right, let's see it. Vanna, if you please, the word is puck fist. Puck fist. Puck fist.
Presenting Vanna, ladies and gentlemen, dressed by Versace, shoes by Payless.
Feel it deep inside, I'm on a ride.
All right, the word is puck fist. Let's go to your comedy entertainer, Jeff Harms.
I want to thank Team 7. The word is puck fist. It's a word you don't want to say if you're dyslexic. Now, I love animals, and I lived on a ranch for many years. I used to wake up and just love to smell that fresh dairy air. And I spent many years as a shepherd, and I had to quit. I got a staph infection. And, I made a U-turn. I had to take it on the lamb. I'm serious. I won't fleece you. But if anyone's ever been to France or Belgium, the French and the Belgish people have a particular delicacy that they use in cooking. It's extremely expensive. They actually have festivals regarding this particular thing. Anybody know what I'm referring to? Truffles. Truffles, they're used in cooking. They're very rare, very expensive. They're in the fungus family, and I know I'm a fun guy. Hello, so. Anyway, by the way, Jim, you know the difference between a shower curtain and toilet paper?
No.
Oh, you're the guy. Oh. Now. Anyway, do you know how the French find the truffle, or as the French call it, les truffles? How do they find it? With pigs, or as the French call them, el porqué. And the French truffle farmer, le farmer du truffle, will go into el woodness, el forestio, with el porqué, and you'll hear this tomorrow in Quebec, by the way. And when they see the pig burrowing for where the truffle is, about 2-3 inches underground, he'll call his assistant, you know, Jacques, quick, I'm paraphrasing. And Jacques will come with a puck fist, which is a tool, a rake, a three-pronged rake, with a screen around it, much like we'd have on our porches in the summer months. And what they do is they'll see where the pig is burrowing with its snout. They'll put that little thing in front of the pig's snout. They'll dig out the truffle themselves, pull it away. The screen protects it from the pig, and that's how they get the truffle. Puckfist is a truffle tool.
All right, very good. Truffle tool, Puckfist. Jimmy.
Puckfist is a Filipino word, and as you know, Filipinos get their P's and their F's mixed up. Ingrid, would you help me out with this one?
I cannot.
I actually know this. I spent 4 summers up in Alaska, and do we have any Inuits here? It's an Inuit term. They're found in Juneau, Alaska, all over Alaska, but northern Canada. It's an Inuit term, and I had an opportunity to do some great excursions up there. One of them, actually, was a dog sledding adventure. You took a helicopter, you landed, did the dog sledding for a while, and I found out that a puckfist is actually the brake on a dog sled. It's called a puckfist. It's an Inuit term for a brake on a dog sled.
Liar. Wow, a voice from the rear, that's hard to do.
Not for a cruise director.
Puckfist. Romano.
Puckfist is dyslexic masturbation. No, actually, puckfist is it's actually a venereal disease or a sexually transmitted disease contracted through having sex with birds. It used to be called chirpes. It's actually a canarial disease, and it's untweetable.
Will it affect your cock or two?
Yeah. That is so funny.
Did mine.
I heard the fungus grows on the pecker. The beak?
Yes. And it affects the tailbone or the coccyx. All right. I don't know. She wrote it. No, a puck fist. I'll actually tell you what this is because I'm a good gun enthusiast with a stutter, and I like antique muskets and rifles and things like that. And what a puck fist is actually a flint, a small stone flint that they would put into the where the hammer hits in order to ignite the gunpowder in an antique musket. Puck fist.
All right. Last but not least, Ingrid.
Okay, this word, it starts with a P. It's actually a ye old English term for a loud and arrogant boaster. Okay, it's for someone who's loud, obnoxious, very arrogant. I actually ran into three of them, three little midgets. Can I say midgets? Small people? Okay.
Sure.
Okay. They were in front of the Guinness Book of World Records and they were making bets with each other. You couldn't miss them. They were being, you know, just being very rowdy right in front of the door there, and they were making bets. And I said, I bet I'll go in there, I'll have my hands measured, and I'll bet I have the world's smallest hands. He goes in, gets measured up, he comes out with a certificate and says, yes, see, check it out, I have the world's smallest hands. He's very happy. The second one goes in and makes a bet with his friends. Oh yeah, I'll bet you I have the world's smallest feet. He goes in, gets his little feet measured, he comes out with a certificate and says, yes, see, check it out, I do have the world's smallest feet. The third one makes a bet with his friends. It's, oh yeah, you think that's good? I'm gonna go in there and get measured. I'll bet you I have the world's smallest wee-wee. And he gets measured, he goes in, and he comes out crying. He's just devastated. He's coming out with a piece of paper. I don't have the world's smallest wee-wee. Who the hell is Jimmy Kovel? Loud and arrogant boaster. That's the truth, because Filipina girls never lie. Thank you.
All right, let's quickly recap. Jeff, Puckfist.
Puckfist is the least known Jackson. Right in between Jermaine and Latoya is Puckfist Jackson. He wrote a song called Beat Me. It's a truffle tool.
Trouble tool, Jimmy?
It's an Inuit term for a break on a dog sled.
Romano?
It is a flint placed in the barrel, next to the hammer on an antique musket.
And Ingrid?
It's a ye old English term for a loud and arrogant boaster.
All right, teams, we turn it over to you. Talk about it. Team number one, what do you say? We need a consensus here. Team one, who do you think?
Having trouble voting, are you from Florida?
Going with Jeff. Jeff, all right, team number one's going with Jeff. Team two, Jeff. Team three,
Ingrid.
Team four.
Thank you.
Romano. Team 5.
Jeff.
Jeff. Team 6. Ingrid. Team 7.
Yeah, I
seven.
Got two votes. I feel like Al Gore.
Team 7.
Romano.
Team 8.
Romano.
Team 9. Jeff.
Mush, people, mush.
And finally, Team 10.
This is not multiple choice.
Going with Jeff, Team 10?
She's saying one.
Oh, you're going with Romano then, are you, Team 10? Romano, all right, that's right. Very good, settle down. All right,
college
panelist. With the panelist who is telling the truth, please stand up now. Was Ingrid. Ingrid was telling the truth. A loud and arrogant boaster. Filipino girls never lie.
They never lie alone.
No one nailed that wire.
Be nice now. Ingrid's very religious. You go by her cabin anytime, all you hear is, oh God, oh God.
Oh, come on, Jeff. I went by earlier this evening to drop off the words to you, and I didn't realize you liked chocolate so much. All I heard coming from your cabin was, oh Henry, oh Henry, oh Henry.
Well, you know, actually, I didn't realize that Jimmy was such a James Bond fan. Every time I walk past his cabin, I just hear, Roger, more, Roger, more, Roger, more.
I didn't know you were a prude. I walked by, all I heard you say, Doctor, no, Doctor, no.
I think it's time for our final word of the night. Where's Vanna? Where is Vanna?
I think she's taking a piss on you.
Jimmy, stop checking under the table. Where is Vanna?
Oh, coming down the middle.
Coming down the middle as she normally does. Vanna, the last word is love. Other side there, Vanna. There you go. Lovecock is the last word. Lovecock. Final word of the night is love.
Push it. Push it. Push it.
Push it. The word is lobcock, and let's ask Jimmy or Cruise Director.
Why does Ingrid have one more brain cell than a horse? So she doesn't poop during parades. What's the first thing that Ingrid does when she wakes up in the morning? Goes home.
Hi, I'm Jimmy, your cruise director, and I can't move my neck.
Don't start with me, Thomas. Okay, lobcock. I actually know this. Because I used to lobcock. No, I did. Before I worked on cruise ship, I used to work on ferries. Just a smaller ship, that's all. And believe it or not, I was gonna say that's just a little over the edge. No, but I used to work on ferries going from Provincetown to Nantucket, and I would lobcock in the ferries. I was a tosser. And when I used to work on the ferries, what that is I would work on the rope deck, and you might have seen that video on the TV with Ingrid and I. And basically when you pull alongside next tomorrow in Quebec, when we have tropical weather tomorrow in Quebec, you're going to actually see people lobbing cock in the morning from the rope deck. And basically you have that large hemp line that goes around the pier, but attached to that is a small nylon rope, and at the end of that is a very heavy ball. I actually picked one up on that video. They call it a lob cock. That's a small heavy nylon ball. That's what they used to throw ashore to the longshoremen. They grab that, sometimes they wrap it around a bumper of a car, and they pull the actual line up and then wrap it on the pier. But the end of the mooring line is called a lob cock.
End of a mooring line, lobcock. Romano.
Lobcock is what Lorena Bobbitt does on a Sunday evening drive.
Hey, you know, she was never convicted of that.
Why is that?
Because the evidence wouldn't stand up in court.
Hey, lobcock is, no, I happen to know this because I used to manage a Jewish punk band called the Four Skins. And, they were a hardcore band. They were cut off at every bar in town. And the keyboard player was an amazing man. He had no arms and no legs. Keyboard player, no arms, no legs. From the Poconos. And one day we were auditioning new drummers, and we auditioned this one guy, and he cut him. He said, no, thank you, we'll call you. And the guy left, and I said, well, why'd you cut him? He was really good, he played well. And he said, well, the guy's a lobcock, man. I said, what's a lobcock? He said, well, he can play well, but he's like that, no personality. He's like dull, a boring guy. And that's what a lobcock is. It's a dull or a boring person, like, you know, a librarian or a cruise director or a, yeah, a lobcock, a dull, boring person.
Ingrid.
Lobcock. Lobcock is someone born of parents of two different nations. I am a lobcock. My father is Norwegian. My mother's Filipina. I am Norwegian. Or Filipina, whatever you prefer. I've met a lot of other Norwegians actually on cruise ships. We all end up working on cruise ships, very important, you know, jobs up to officer level, but we get paid minimum wage. It's awful. And my other friend, she's a half German, half Irish. She is Germish. She turned out to be a very bossy alcoholic. It's very sad. And my other best friend, she's half American, half French. And I love hanging out with her until we go over to the beach and everyone sees that she only has one armpit shaven. Half American, half French.
I got a friend who's a lobcock, actually. His mother is from Iceland, and his father's from Cuba, so he's an ice cube.
I had a friend who was half Japanese and half African American, and every December 7th, he attacked Pearl Bailey.
Actually, I went to a lobcock restaurant the other day. It was half German and half Chinese. A half hour later, I was hungry for power.
Now, I know this, a friend of yours, she's half from Fiji and half from China.
Fitch. Oh, we don't talk about that. We'll let them figure that out.
So that's what... Take out a piece of paper. A lobcock is someone born of parents of two different nations.
Jeff Harms.
Lobcock is a terrible abuse of animal. It's chicken tossing. No. Anybody know what the word shuttlecock is? It's a well-endowed astronaut. No, it's a... It is the object, the main object in the sport or the game of badminton, which was invented in Wales again, I think. It's actually invented in England, and the shuttlecock is the thing that you serve. It's like the ball in tennis. We all know that. Anyway, it's very simple. Lobcock, if you've ever played tennis or that, you get two serves. The first serve's not good, then you get your second serve. Lobcock is the second serve in badminton.
Second serve in badminton, all right.
What are you, Bjorn Borg over there?
Jimmy.
Recap, a lobcock is the ball at the end of a mooring line.
Romano.
It's lobcock is Japanese for a stolen penis. No, a lobcock is actually a wallet made out of human foreskins, and when you rub it, it turns into a briefcase. I know this because I got a sunburn a couple of weeks ago, and I went to the doctor, and he gave me Viagra. I said, "Is that going to help with the sunburn?" He said, "No, but it'll keep the sheets off your legs." With sunburn. No, a lobcock is a dull and boring person.
Ingrid.
A lobcock is a mythical flying squirrel flying with a bush who's loud and arrogant and hangs out with midgets. Lobcock was Jimmy's nickname in college. Lobcock is someone born of parents of two different nations.
Jeff.
The second serve in badminton.
All right, audience, we turn it over to you. One last time, talk about it.
What is going on?
All right, teams. Team number one, who do you think is telling the truth one last time? Jeff. Team number one's going for Jeff this time. Team two? Jimmy. Team three? Jimmy. Team four? Jimmy. Team five? Jimmy. Team six? Team 7.
Jimmy.
Team 8.
Jimmy.
Team number 9. And team 10.
Jimmy.
Look at that.
9 out of 10.
Would the panelist who is telling the truth please stand up now? Dull and boring person, Romano. Ladies and gentlemen, can we have a big round of applause for our Vanna here on her last performance on board the Dawn, going to the Pearl. Also, the boys on the sound of the light back there. We've got Mar and I believe it is Gilbert back there. Give them a nice round of applause, doing the sound of the light this evening. And a huge round of applause for our panelists here this evening, your cruise director, Jimmy, Jeff Harms, Ingrid Thomas, and Romano Frediani. How about a nice round of applause?
Last Flyers Club on board the Norwegian Dawn. Thank you.
Have a great night, folks. Don't forget, the casino's open. There's still lots to do. Have a fabulous night here on board the Dawn. Don't forget,